What did you say?
One day I'll grow as tall as you.
Oh. I feel like I was just out here.
Yeah.
Okay, you guys, let's see, you're not Crunchbase. I gotta go back a couple pages. Did you listen to that?
I listened to some of it.
So they desperately want to spin Crunchbase off from AOL, but they can't say it on stage. But of course everybody knows it because they're always talking about it in, you know, in private meetings, so that was kind of fun. So, and I think they should spin it off. What do you think? Crunchbase is an independent entity? You'd invest in that, right, Roelof?
Yeah, I think it's really interesting. I use Crunchbase every week. I was on it yesterday looking at three different companies.
You were on it yesterday?
Yeah, I was using Crunchbase.
Yeah.
I love it.
I love it too.
We all love it.
So, but that's not what we're here to talk about. We're here to talk about Whisper. And you are the founder and CEO of Whisper.
Co-founder.
Co-founder and CEO of Whisper.
Yeah.
And Roelof, you invested in Whisper.
Correct.
Okay. So we had an interesting prep call the other day for this this interview where I expressed some feelings about Whisper and Secret, and you expressed counter feelings about Whisper. And
I think interesting is a really unique way to characterize it.
And to your credit, I actually suggested that I may not, because of my feelings for these services, maybe I'm not the best person to interview you. And to your credit, you said, no, you absolutely want the hard questions and you want to talk to the audience about.
Well, you know, I think, again, like Whisper is all about creating a place of authenticity and a place of openness. And
right.
Just because you're going to ask hard questions, for me not to do the interview simply because of that would be antithetical to what Whisper is all about.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's no question that you shouldn't be able to ask me that I can't absolutely hold my head up high and
okay.
answer.
So we'll have a few questions later, but let's start with the easy stuff. So tell me about the original inspiration for Whisper and why and what your mission is.
Yeah, I mean, you know, listen, I think we're living in this remarkable time where for the first time in human history, like people are learning about their peers based solely on what I want to show you, right? So like it's this 24/7 highlight reel, right? Like, you know, my friends probably are looking at my Facebook and saying, oh my God, Michael's like so cool and awesome. And he's at, you know, TechCrunch Disrupt and he's doing all these amazing things. And they don't know that I'm like sitting here stressed out saying, oh my God, Arrington's gonna kick my ass in this interview and I'm gonna look like an idiot. You know, that's all they're seeing is the highlight reel, right? And they're not seeing
stuff.
The behind the scenes.
The marriages, but not the divorces.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And, you know, I think, again, like, one of the things that's so interesting about how we form opinions about ourselves is we do it in relation to how we see the world around us, right?
Yeah.
And if my reference is that everyone else is awesome, then, like, by default, like, I must be a loser. It's like, how do I know that I'm tall? Because you're short. It's all based on reference.
Okay.
And, like, it's many, many hours a day of consuming media of how awesome your life is. I think we're, you know, it's creating a lack of empathy in the world. And that's not just me. That's, you know, there was a study from the University of Michigan that said college kids today are 40% less empathetic than, you know, their counterparts even, you know, 20 years ago.
Okay.
Like, so, and I just want to say, like, that's a really, really big deal. Like,
so hold on, because we're going to be able to unpack this slowly, but let's stick to what is your mission? Is it to fix the lack of empathy in the world? Or that's not it, right? So what is the mission of Whisper?
Well, I want to live in a more empathetic, more caring, more compassionate, tolerant, understanding world, right? And again, I think Whisper is not about concealing identity. It's about because that makes it sound sinister. And that's not what it is at all. It's about creating a place where we're not carrying around this 800-pound gorilla with us that we call our identity, right? So there's just, it's a simply
So your mission is to create a more caring, more empathetic, more tolerant world. I just want to get this exactly right for later on in the interview. So those are your words, is that right?
Yeah.
Mike,
that is 100% absolutely our mission.
Okay.
Right, and as part of that, that means, you know, a more open world, a more aware world, where, you know, again, like, I want to live in a world, like, maybe in 100 years from now, we're going to live in a world where Whisper doesn't even exist in its present form, where we're just all so intimately close to one another that nothing is taboo, nothing is weird, and not, you know, we just come on here and everyone is just like,
nothing
like,
is taboo.
Hey, you know, this is what's going on with me today, you know, I'm, you know, my parents are, you know, cheating on each other, or like, oh, I just
I'm sorry, your parents are.
This is an example where one day, like,
because if somebody were to write, your parents are cheating on each other on Whisper, you wouldn't be okay with that. You would feel bad for your parents, I would imagine.
Absolutely. And by the way, like, that's actually something that's really, really close to home. My parents went through a divorce. There was infidelity. Like, they're, you know, and I'm, again, it's not something like, this is the mission. My mom's probably watching this and, like, she's dying. But
she what?
I said, my mom's probably watching this and is like, you know.
She's saying, he's such a good boy.
Exactly.
I'm so glad he's talking about our divorce in front of thousands of people.
Why should anything, we shouldn't be embarrassed of anything. Like, we have these smartphones in our pocket where we can connect to any other person on the planet, and we shouldn't feel disconnected from one another. Like, maybe I'm, you know, living in this utopian, crazy world that's not real, but that's the kind of world I'd like to live in.
So your mission isn't to create the perfect bullying app. And honestly, that's how I started the conversation the other day. And you have moved me quite a ways away from that in a couple of conversations. But what?
To be fair, Mike, also, like, by just using the product, right?
Pardon?
By just using the product, I'm sure that's
no. Just using the product, like, I see nothing but. Well, there's some stupid stuff, you know, like sexist, and I want to find a girl or whatever, but there's a lot of beautiful stuff on there, people sort of saying beautiful things or reaching out for help. And I'd say that the experience of opening Whisper makes me feel better about life than by the time I'm done than it did at the beginning. Now, the Secret is sort of the opposite to me, and I know you don't always love being compared to Secret, but can you tell us how you see what the difference is between the two apps?
Listen. I only know about Whisper, right? And what I can tell you is that, like, from day one, before even a single line of code was written, like, we said, this must be not only a safe place, like, this must be the safest place around, right? And that's exactly what we did. So we made a lot of decisions, like, hey, you know, no address book integration, right? And again, the reason for that is that I didn't want to create a place where people use this to be mean to their friends or people they know.
And you told me on the phone something interesting about that the other day, about if you use the address book for anonymous talking, you said it's always going to be negative. Because if you have something nice to say about someone, you're going to tell them to their face publicly. Right? Did I get that right?
Again, yeah. I mean,
can I help? Yeah. I think using the address book just lends itself to abuse.
Right.
Doesn't mean that it would be,
right?
But it just has greater potential for.
So you decided no address book.
Well, I will not be part of a product that, you know, I don't want, like, kids, you know, sitting up at night crying where somebody posts something about them and they can't get it down under any circumstance, right?
So, like, beyond the address book, you actually don't allow.
This is an important thing. Like,
go on.
No, I mean, this is all important stuff, but this is important stuff. Like,
You're about to say something very important.
Well, no. Monica Lewinsky just came out with a Vanity Fair article where she talked about this kid, you know, in New Jersey who, at Rutgers, who,
right.
One of his friends posted a webcam photo of him making out with another guy.
Yeah.
And he wasn't, like, this wasn't public information.
Right.
The next day he jumped off the George Washington Bridge.
Right.
So I will never be a part of a product that enables anyone to ever feel like that, ever.
Right. So could we just put up on screen the thing that I prepared?
Yeah. I don't even know what you've prepared. I have preparations also.
So, okay, so you were saying you never want anyone to be, you know, singled out or talked about specifically on the service.
Yeah.
You never want anyone to feel bad. So explain that a little bit.
Yeah.
Right.
So this is obviously a Whisper that a user posted, right, about Gwyneth Paltrow. Right?
You knew that without even looking up. Or can you, can see it right there. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh.
That's okay, right? So, yeah. Mike, here's the thing.
I wish we could have not had that there. I was hoping that would just be up there while you. But go ahead. You're talking about Gwyneth Paltrow.
They did it. They took it away here. You guys can't see, but
amazing people back there doing things.
I know. Yeah. I know. No. Listen. Well, let's get closer. I want to consciously couple with you.
Oh. Okay.
No. Here's the thing.
I have no idea what to do with that.
Here's the.
Why is this okay? Because you said, and just a quote, we want a more caring, more empathetic, more tolerant world. How does outing somebody cheating on her husband make us a more caring, more empathetic.
So this is a post that a user posted, right, that, again, like, when we built this service, we had specific use cases in mind. And then other use cases started coming in. We had people talking about, you know, leaders of the Mormon Church or different government officials,
right,
or, you know, all of these things that are what we call in the public domain, right?
Yeah.
And I think that when you are in the public domain, you're in the business of promoting yourself, right?
Yeah.
That's your business. That's your entire livelihood, right? You're
right.
In the service of people, right? And I think that we made a decision that we were not in the business of censorship, right? And we said, okay, here's what we consider to be public domain.
But
right?
You are in the business of censorship, Mike, with non-public figures, right? Just to clarify.
That's not censorship, that's safety.
Okay, so when
censorship is something that is of information that belongs to the people, right? Like Barack Obama is a public figure. These, like, government officials, okay, are public figures. Gwyneth Paltrow is a public figure. The director of X-Men is a public figure, right? He derives his livelihood by being in the service of the people, right?
Right?
And so, again, like, we decided that there is information that is of, when people have information that is about public figures and people that are in the public domain, and by the way, it's very important to recognize that this is something that we have very clearly, narrowly defined editorial guidelines of what we consider to be public domain, right? Like, Mike Arrington is not a public figure. This is something that is of absolute global relevancy that
so
everyone
you,
in the entire
you
world
you have a list
knows.
Of people that you're allowed to trash on the service?
It's not about trashing people on the service. That's not...
Can we just have that up there again?
Put it up again. Like, please put it up.
Because to me, let me speak for 1 second. When I use the app, and anyone here who's used the app, and raise your hand if you have, it's a very positive experience, what you generally see on Whisper. It's lovely, the things you see. Why is this crap part of your business model as well? How do those two things fit together?
Like, it's not about being a part of our business model. It's that we, right, again, like, made a decision that we're not going, if somebody comes onto the service, right, and says, I work at the NSA, and your president is abusing his constitutional powers and is illegally reading your emails and listening to your phone calls, right? And then we go through the process of vetting that. Because, by the way, that's the other component here,
right,
is that we allow zero proper names on the service. So I cannot go on there and say...
Well, not, you know, zero proper names.
Let me speak.
Yeah.
Well, I cannot go on there and say that Mike Arrington, you know, is an asshole and blah, 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 and all this stuff, and he's, you know, being mean to... No. Guys, I didn't mean it that way. He's actually come
think,
a long... You should
think,
have heard the prep call. You should have heard the prep call. He's come a long way.
Roelof, okay, what do you think
hold,
about...
Hold on, let me just...
About,
I'm almost done.
But
I'm
hold
almost
on.
Done.
This is a conversation, and I'm not trying to cut you off. I want you to talk, but I also want to guide the conversation towards what I want to talk about a little bit. And so...
I thought we were going to talk about what I wanted to talk about.
Roelof, what do you think about the Gwyneth Paltrow thing? Should that have been...
It's not... Let me just finish here, okay? I think that... Here's what we said. We said, this is what we define to be public domain. This is information that belongs to the public, right?
Right.
And from there, we said, okay, now we have a responsibility to make sure that this stuff is actually true and that we know it to not be false, because we're not going to arm the public and our users with it, just lies and gossip and rumors and bullshit. Like, we're not going to do that. That's not what we're about. We're in the business of truth, right? And...
Well, hold on. You didn't say that, because I was very clear with you on your mission. You didn't say business of truth. You said a more caring, more empathetic, more tolerant world.
I think truth is a synonym with some of those words.
Caring and truth is a synonym? Empathetic and truth? Tolerant? Those are words...
Empathetic is absolutely, like, you derive empathy from knowing what's going on, you know, in the world around you. That's,
okay.
That's how you become empathetic. It's by driving
Here's what I would
awareness.
Suggest. Let
Here's
Roelof talk for you for a second, only because... He has his own view on this.
But,
and he
Mike,
can,
I don't want... The thing
also,
is that this is such a minuscule
all the way to
part
New York,
of what Whisper is. This is
you.
Such a minuscule part of what Whisper is. This is not what we see the service about.
Sure.
I have a few slides that I actually want to show
okay.
as well. So let's... Can we cue my slides? Right? Okay. This is the overarching type of stuff that we see on Whisper, right? I pray every night that I'll wake up straight and maybe my parents will love me again. Like, what the fuck? I don't want to live in a society where anybody ever feels that way, like ever, not even for 1 second. Nobody should ever feel that way, period. And
what if their parents don't love them? They should be able to write that. That's a beautiful thing that they can write that.
It is a beautiful thing that they can write that, but again,
And you have a foundation that you've created that actually helps these people, right? Let's talk about that for a little bit.
Yeah, so again, like this is something, you know, we have a lot of military people who use Whisper, right?
You know,
like,
you can keep talking about it, but I just gave you a terrifically positive statement to riff off of. And so how do you, what is this foundation? And then you can go back to these, but tell me about that.
Sure, so we started a nonprofit foundation. You know, by the way, this was not a reactive thing. This was something that we did at the very beginning, right? Where it's called Your Voice. And the whole idea is we really want to tell everyone, like, hey, it's okay to be yourself. Like, whoever you are is okay. You're gay, you're straight, you're black, you're white, you're fat, you're ugly, you're, you know, anorexic, you're bulimic, like, whatever. Like, just talk about it with anybody, like, whether it's a family member, a stranger, a parent, a teacher, like, just use your voice.
And do you think that you have saved any lives?
Again, like, it's about, like, not a day goes by.
Oh, that's such a neat, I just, like, it's like a softball.
Well, because
softball.
The truth is, like, you know the answer. Everyone in the audience knows the answer.
What's the answer?
Yes.
Have you saved lives?
Every single day. Minute, anytime anybody posts something where they talk about, like, taking their own life, like, or putting themselves in harm's way, we immediately, that post gets watermarked, the user gets redirected to the National Suicide Hotline, and they also get, you know, sent to our nonprofit. This was not a reactive PR stunt that we did. This was something that we did at the very beginning.
It's a beautiful thing.
We had a student.
So why Gwyneth Paltrow? Why do you do all these beautiful things, and then you're like, fuck it, let's hire a guy from Gawker to write about Gwyneth Paltrow cheating on her husband. How does that all fit together? It doesn't. Roelof, what do you think?
Hold on. I'm almost done. No, he almost did it. He's not going to do that. I want to talk about, because he mentioned one of our hires, you know, Nitsan. Nitsan is not on stage. I'm on stage. Nitsan's backstage. I'd love to introduce you afterwards. I'm sure you guys will hit it off. But the reason why we hired Nitsan, here we go. This is a Whisper right here. This is one of the things we see every single day. So this is somebody screenshotted the watermark version of their Whisper that I posted.
Can I just say, you and I have been talking for almost 20 minutes. May I talk to Roelof as well?
Yes.
Okay.
You may talk to Roelof, but last thing. No, because
board meetings are a lot of fun.
It's not.
No, because on Nitsan Zimmerman, who we hired from Gawker, right?
Yeah.
Again, this is a very important point.
It's very important point.
It's all important stuff. The reason we hired Nitsan is because this is one of the greatest storytellers working on the internet today, right? He's been called the editor of the internet, the Kobe Bryant of viral content. This is a guy who, you know, doesn't do takedowns. That's not what he's about. He, you know, discovers
Gwyneth
great
Paltrow.
Viral content.
Hey, right? Just hold on. Roelof.
I feel like the burden.
Yeah, that was my point.
I think the thing about providing a place that has integrity and provides for creating a more tolerant society depends on people not telling lies. People not telling lies.
Right.
And that includes white lies, where I think not living your life truthfully snowballs in very unintended ways, where you end up hurting many, many people. And the way that I reconcile the Gwyneth, you know, Gwyneth is one example. There are many other examples of things that are in the public domain where whistleblowing has an important role. And you can think of some of the function of Whisper is enabling posts like what we see right now, but some of it is enabling grassroots whistleblowing. And some of that is actually really important for society. And when you're on the board of a public company, for example, it's mandatory for the company to have a whistleblowing hotline to enable employees to complain about harassment or malfeasance in the company, or for customers to be able to voice complaints in a way that is safe. And I think that's part of what Whisper provides. It's not something that Michael anticipated when he started the service. And when there is a public figure and the company can vet that the information is true, it seems to be in the public good for that information to be shared. And that might be an abuse taking place in a company, in a church, in a military base, or it might be a celebrity who's an actress.
Okay, so if you had never posted the Gwyneth Paltrow stuff, it just hadn't happened yet, and today you got the same information, and would you post it now, or have you changed your mind on that?
Mike, again, I think that we...
That's a straightforward question. I just asked if you've changed your mind on that. If the answer is no, it's no. If it's yes, it's yes.
Listen, I'm sure that I'll make mistakes, tons and tons
would
and
you
tons
do that
and tons
again?
Of mistakes.
Would you do that again?
Yes, absolutely. Yes. We didn't post it. I want you to understand something. We didn't post it. We didn't feature it. We didn't, like, would I allow it to be on the service? After we vetted it to be true, yes. Okay. We've said already that we are not in the business of censoring information that belongs to the public.
Well, no, you said you're in the business of creating a more caring, more empathetic, more tolerant world.
I understand that, but Mike, we're also not in the business of, like, Gwyneth Paltrow is somebody who she works for the public. That's where she derives, you know, her livelihood.
Okay. Do you think she maybe cried that night after this was posted? Do you think she was sad?
Mike, I have no idea.
Is she a human being?
Of course she's a human being. Please. Yes.
But she's on a list. There's people on a list who aren't human beings.
She's a human being, but she's also in the business of promoting herself, right?
Listen.
Again, hold on. I want to understand. This is, again, such a minuscule part of what we do.
And I agree.
I feel that it's taking, like you should read.
So I felt that this interview would have been us saying. No, I'm going to talk for a minute. I'm going to talk for just a minute. I would have thought we'd come up here and we talk about how wonderful Whisper is and how bad Secret is and Whisper's this and that and the other thing. And then it'd be like, oh, there's the Gwyneth Paltrow thing, and we'd laugh. And then you'd say, you know what? We thought about it, and we're not going to do that anymore. We're not going to allow even public figures necessarily, you know, we're not going to allow celebrity gossip on there. And then I go, oh, that's great. And then Roelof and I would talk about his $12 billion portfolio, and then we'd all go to lunch. I seriously thought that was how this interview was going to go. And it's gone a different way, and that's fine. I think we can all agree that Whisper has, I feel that Whisper has 95, 98% of it is beautiful and wonderful and helping the world. We're going to disagree on the part about whether outing Gwyneth Paltrow for cheating on her husband is helping the world. And that's okay. We can disagree on that.
By the way, that information is not helping the world. Let's be very, very clear about that. It's not about that.
Right. It's about your business model.
It's not about our business
model. This is not something that the company solicited. This is a user who posted it. Yep. And I think the thing that's tricky is there are many examples where this sort of whistleblowing is actually really important. What if it turns
totally
out,
agree.
You know,
yeah.
there are a lot of soldiers on the service. What if they're posting something about an abuse that's taking place
right.
at one of our military bases?
Right.
I think it's pretty important for that kind of information
totally agree.
To come out. And
yeah.
so if that happens and they're referencing some senior leader in the military, is that then okay or not okay?
Because
then
I think it's okay.
But then how do you, so the problem then is, right. how do you distinguish between that versus Gwyneth?
I think everyone in this room could distinguish between those two things pretty easily.
Like, again, I...
So do you.
No.
Celebrity gossip is different from real news, where real people need to be heard, right?
So, again, this is not about... So we're not TMZ. We're not in the business of celebrity gossip.
Yeah,
That's
and then you hire the guy from Gawker, which
guy
is
from,
about...
Hold on. This is like one... Honestly, this... You should... Everybody should actually read the post that Nitsan did on PTSD in soldiers. It's particularly using data from Whisper, where we looked at mentions around the topic of PTSD, and what we learned is that PTSD is talked about 80 times more at Fort Hood than any other place in the entire world, right? Like, and there's been two shootings now, there. Hold on.
Thinks that Whisper is good for the world after this conversation? Really, I would expect almost everyone to agree with me on this. Okay. Who thinks that they shouldn't be posting celebrity gossip? Who thinks that the Gwyneth Paltrow stuff is actually okay? That's about 50-50, right?
Yeah.
Right. So I think that, and most people here seem to think that Whisper is a good service, and I agree. Roelof.
Maybe that's note. The only way to show me.
Do you want to say hi to your mother again, or?
Now, everyone, please read Nitsan's PTSD post. This is like one of the defining important issues of our time.
So there are some really important things I want to talk to Roelof about, so we're going to go over time a little bit, and I'm sorry about that backstage, but I gave you back a little time last time. Just want to give you a heads up. I'm talking to people back there. Roelof, you're doing pretty well. There's an article I just read about how your current portfolio is about $12 billion. Is that correct?
The Sequoia portfolio?
No, your personal Sequoia portfolio has current value of around $12 billion. Is that right?
I don't know. I don't track that.
Oh, I bet you track that.
No.
I bet you know down to the dollar how much.
Firstly, I don't do that. And to be honest, at Sequoia, we think about it as our portfolio, not my portfolio.
Well, sure, after WhatsApp, you definitely want to think of it more as
yes, definitely.
Yeah. But you're doing quite well.
Thank you for saying that.
Last year, you're always on stage at Disrupt. Thank you. And last year, you were very sneaky. And it turned out you were selling Tumblr while you were here.
No, Yahoo was buying Tumblr.
Right, you were helping Yahoo buy Tumblr. I mean, that's right. So
it was true. The morning before we were on stage that day, we were actually over at the offices helping negotiate some of the terms.
And so I noticed you were kind of late today, rolling in here. What are you working on right now in New York? Do you have any New York portfolio companies currently?
MongoDB. I'm on the board of Mongo, which has a significant office here in New York City.
Were you at MongoDB this morning?
I was not.
No. I want to talk to you about, I want to get your thought on this trend we're seeing with single-purpose apps and how, like Foursquare, for example, a couple of days ago announced that they're splitting their app up into two different apps. What's going on here? Are you seeing this? And, you know, are you, Evernote, is they have, how are they thinking about this in your other portfolio companies?
Yeah, I don't know if this is something that a lot of other people have been tracking, but there's an interesting dilemma in the App Store, in my mind, or with mobile apps in general, where in the US, it seems that the apps are becoming thinner. And users, at least in the US, are not embracing full-featured apps quite as much. And so you've seen Facebook split off Messenger and Paper. You've seen Dropbox split off some of its apps. You've seen that with Foursquare most recently. Google obviously did that several years ago with standalone apps for Maps and for Gmail and for YouTube and things like that. And so it's interesting. I don't know how many people in the audience use Evernote. But inside the Evernote mobile app, it has a document scanner, a PDF scanner, which is really, really good. But if you go search in the App Store for PDF scanner, Evernote doesn't show up. There are a bunch of other standalone PDF scanners. And so there are a bunch of people, like at Evernote, we worry about the fact that we're missing out on the opportunity of serving customers who want a PDF scanning capability. But the only way we can address that because of the way people search in App Stores is to have maybe a standalone app. I don't know, does that make sense? And it's interesting, in Asia, people have much fatter applications. So a company like WeChat, for example, has chat and commerce and social all embedded in a single application. And I think some of the problems in my mind is the way that search works in app stores and the way that you can't have deep linking within applications. Because users are looking for a very specific need or tool that they want to use, and the app store doesn't expose that in a richer application today.
So what do you think Evernote will go in that direction as well?
Well, Evernote has a couple of standalone apps. We have a business card, Hello, which has been a standalone app. We had Evernote Food, Penultimate. So we actually have a portfolio of applications, and right. It's, I think in all our portfolio companies that have a significant mobile application, it's an ongoing debate about whether or not you should have the single app or whether you need to have multiple that serve sort of different use cases.
Yeah. And?
It's a tough call because, there are tens of millions of users who use Evernote and love the full-featured capability.
Yeah.
And, do you go against that by having sort of very thin single-purpose applications? I don't know. I don't know what the right answer is.
Now, you're on subject change. You're on the board of Square, is that right?
Correct.
So what's going on? Like, there's a lot of negative rumors about Square filing for an IPO and pulling it, acquisition talks. Is the company, is it falling apart?
No, I really don't know where all this misinformation came from.
So what's true and what's not true with the rumors?
Well,
so
there was a post earlier this week that compared Square and Box,
you know,
for shelving IPO plans. And, last time I checked, Square never filed. Square never made their filing public, and they never withdrew their public filing. So to me, that's a pretty big difference. Any one of our later stage companies is thinking, gee, maybe this year we should go public, maybe next year, we don't know, we think about it. So
Do
those sort of conversations happen at Square? Of course, they happen at every one of these later stage companies where there's people contemplate, should we go public this year, maybe not, are there things we should invest in? And the thing people need to remember is that going public is an irreversible event. And I always think very carefully about those decisions in life that you can't go back on. And once you lead life as a public company, you have quarterly earnings, and your ability to invest in growth is severely curtailed. So there's a big difference between the two. There's a lot of misinformation.
What about, was Square trying desperately to sell itself the last several months?
No.
No discussions whatsoever?
No.
None?
None. I mean, I was on the phone with the Wall Street Journal about this. I was like, where are you getting this stuff?
What did they say?
They said they had reliable sources, and being at the board of the company, I was like, well, that'd be kind of a surprise to me to find out that we're busy selling ourselves because none of us are aware of it.
So Square is stronger than ever. Everything's great. All the rumors are false, and somebody's just slandering it.
Yeah, I've been trying to think about where the source of this misinformation is because I think someone has an axe to grind. I mean, we have a board meeting next week. I saw the board deck last week. The company is thriving.
Are you saying Keith Raboy?
No.
Who used to work? No. No, I thought that's what you were.
No, Keith is at Costa Ventures. Vinod's on the board with me as well.
He's a shareholder. Who has the axe to grind?
Competitors. I mean, I haven't been able to pin it down. I don't care about it that much to try to figure out who's the nub of this misinformation. But, you know, Square is doing really well. The business has wonderful margins. If you go back and look at the way that PayPal thrived, these payments companies have phenomenal operating leverage. Square is starting to do more than just payments and thinking of itself as a commerce company, helping with, you know, some of the things we've announced around Square Capital, whether it's Pickup that was announced recently, providing a full point of sale system for a small merchant, not just being a payments company, helping them with CRM, all these other capabilities. Bookfresh is an acquisition we made to help with bookings for service providers on the platform.
Yeah.
Anyway, I don't know where the misinformation comes from, but I'm thrilled to be involved with the company.
Okay. All right. Well, listen, we went over time, but I really appreciate you guys coming up here and talking with me. And Michael, it was an interesting conversation, and I just want to say that, like, you did great, and like, and you're genuine, and you clearly believe the stuff you're saying, and that's a lot more fun for me than somebody who comes up and just is an expert at deflecting and not. I mean, you answer stuff, and I think you're wrong on the Gwyneth Paltrow part of the business, but I understand that for some reason you disagree with me, but I understand that, you know, you have really good intentions on the rest of the business, and I applaud you for that.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Thanks, Mike.
Thanks very much.
Appreciate it.
All right, thanks.
And thank you, everyone.